Chapter 2. 2 p.m. UTC minus 6. 9 p.m. UTC plus 1. Three new sensations. The first sensation, tightness. The spasm of surprise which accompanied the day skip was restrained by straps across my body. The second sensation, cold. Much colder than it had just been in Jeremy's car. Windy, the light touch of a snowflake on my face. The third sensation, pain. Intense pain in my forehead. My hand found a throbbing bump near the hairline. In the next moment, my senses and brain produced a picture of my reality. I am being put into an ambulance, strapped onto a stretcher. What's happened to me now? The stretcher's motion came to a stop, and a paramedic climbed in beside me. How we doing, Kyle? He asked. Where am I? Where's Jeremy? I asked with a strangely heavy tongue. The paramedic didn't take his eyes away from his tasks while he responded. Not sure who you mean, Kyle. My name is Sean. My partner is Mike. Is Jeremy someone you work with? No matter, he'll be fine. We've got to get you to the hospital. And suddenly I knew. I'm at work. Just after my accident. I grabbed the arm of the paramedic. What's the time? The date? I demanded. The man looked at me with alarm. Easy, guy. It's just after 2 p.m. Today is Friday, January 2nd. To lighten the mood, he added, Happy New Year, by the way. 2015's not getting off to such a great start for you, is it? I lay my head down on the stretcher. And suddenly I laughed, grimacing with pain as I did. But the relief outweighed the discomfort. It's all been the product of my injury. These day skips have been nothing. The paramedic frowned at my oddly timed laughter. Let's go now, he called to the front. I felt the ambulance move. The siren started to wail, but I felt light and free. Clearly, my injured brain had created a bizarre hallucination or something. Whatever it was over. The ambulance made a couple of turns before accelerating. The paramedic took my blood pressure, felt again for my pulse, and told me he had started the intravenous drip. Perhaps 5 minutes later, the vehicle made several more turns and came to a halt. Sean opened the rear doors and, with his partner's help, pulled out my stretcher. I was in a garage-style access room. Cypress Regional Hospital was painted on the wall. An automatic door slid open as the paramedics wheeled me into the emergency ward. They started describing my situation to the waiting medical staff. The smile on my face must have seemed out of place, if anyone had observed it. I didn't care. It was over. When he finished, Sean turned to me. Kyle, they're a little busy here right now, so Mike and I will stay with you until they can take charge of you, he said as he removed the straps which had secured me during the ride. I asked for water. Can I sleep? I asked, suddenly depleted. Sean denied that request and nattered on about why, obviously attempting to keep me alert. I realized I still held my cell phone in my right hand. I looked at it. 2:33 p.m. I smiled again. I'm sure glad I've come back to my senses. Day skips. Yeah, right. Time passed. The paramedics monitored my condition and made small talk. My eyes happened to glance at a clock. It read 2:59. The next moment I found myself lying on the couch in my apartment, staring at an unfinished text message. I saw the time and date on the phone's display, 2 p.m., Saturday, January 3rd, the day after the accident. No, I cried. The day skips are back. With sudden fury, I flung the phone across the room onto my old recliner. I slammed my fist down on the couch and actually thought about kicking a hole in the wall. It was not my finest moment. I stood, breathing hard, and paced around the room. My head was sore, but not nearly as much as it had just been in the emergency ward yesterday. My mind was a confused jumble. I glared at my cell phone, as if it was somehow the cause of the trouble. I grabbed it and reread the message to my boss, which I'd started. Hey Dan, it's Kyle. Thanks for visiting me yesterday. I calmed a little. Okay, I need to know what is going on with work, no matter what else is going on, right? I decided to finish the message, adding, A. Out of hospital now. Am I supposed to be at work on Monday? Send. Now I've got to get out of here. I went to the entryway closet and slipped on boots, heavy jacket, gloves, and toque. I grabbed my keys and exited. Outside, my agitated breathing created clouds of vapor which the wind ripped away. I climbed into my car, wondering for a moment how it got back to my home from work, and the engine groaned to life. Reversed out of the stall, started down the street. Because driving settles me down when I'm scattered. I refused to allow my mind to think about it. I ignored the clock in the car. I sang to the song pumping on my stereo. I drummed my fingers on the dash. I breathed slowly and looked around the small city of Swift Current. I decided to play tour guide to an imaginary passenger. The city gets its name from the speed of the creek which flows through it, down from the Cypress Hills toward the South Saskatchewan River. I guess it is, or was, in the early days, relatively swift. Not like a speedy mountain stream, but speedier than most sluggish prairie streams. As I drove near the creek, a frozen surface concealed any hint of speed at the moment. A sign at the City Museum caught my eye, a military history of Swift Current. On an impulse, I turned into the parking lot. I'd meant to go to the exhibit. Now seems as good a time as any. A pulse of pain throbbed through my head as I exited the car. For the next gloriously ignored amount of time, I thoroughly enjoyed the wartime exhibits and displays. I also thoroughly enjoyed ignoring the problem. A step forward in the museum changed into a step forward in my apartment. My hand extended in a reaching position toward a piece of paper on the table. Another day skip. It's taken me out of Saturday at the museum, I said, hardly surprised anymore. It's probably 2 p.m. on Sunday the 4th. I considered the note on the table. It displayed my name in large letters written in black marker. The writing was my own. A note to myself. No selfie video this time, I mocked in mounting frustration. My hands curled into tight fists. No, I shouted. I won't pick it up. This ends now. I changed course away from the table and into the kitchen. I filled a tall glass with water and downed it in one long gulping set of swallows. I banged the tumbler onto the counter. I stalked back into the living room and sat on the couch. I tried to give my attention to the TV. The halftime show of the playoff football game was almost finished, and the host promised to return after a few words from sponsors. A few too many useless words, I snarled. It was a foolish thing to say, but I didn't care. It was then I realized I knew the outcome of the game. The Colts beat the Bengals 26-10. I read that on the flight I took to Toronto. Or will take to Toronto. The confusion I felt about which verb tense to use in reference to something I remembered as past but which would happen in the future filled me with fresh frustration. I hate what's going on with me! I mashed my fist into a cushion, over and over. Again, not my finest moment. I turned to glare at the note on the table. It seemed to mock me. I went to the window and tried to calm down, but then darted to the table and grabbed the note from myself. I read, Kyle, I know all of this is unsettling. I won't explain it, like I said in the selfie video you got, or will get, when you were in Place de la République. But I'll give you proof you should carry on and get yourself to Paris. You'll be needed there. This is the proof. You're watching Indianapolis play Cincinnati right now. The next scoring play will be a touchdown for Indianapolis just over 7 minutes into the third quarter. Luck passes to Moncrief. Here's another proof. You were in Medicine Hat yesterday evening with Tyler and Jordan at the Broncos-Tigers game. Text them to find out. So believe me when I say you should follow through and go to Paris. And pray, like I told you in the video. One thing I've learned is that God can guide you when you're confused. I looked skeptically at the paper. I put it down, took a pen and a clean sheet of paper, and wrote some of the same words the note held. Identical. Obviously my writing. But why am I being so mysterious? Why don't I just tell myself what's going on instead of all these riddles? I snatched up the note, crumpled it into a tight ball, and threw it into the corner. I returned to the couch. I refused to do anything but watch the game. When 7:09 of playing time had elapsed in the third quarter, Indianapolis scored a touchdown. Andrew Luck scrambled out of a collapsing pocket and passed to Dante Moncrief in the end zone, just like the note said. I grabbed my phone and messaged both Tyler and Jordan. Hey guys, having some memory issues after my accident. Did we go to the Broncos-Tigers game last night? I knew those words might cause my friends to worry.
Maybe they should be worried.
My eye glanced at the time, 2:45 p.m. In a few minutes, Tyler's text came back. Yeah, Kyle, we went to the game. Your head okay? I didn't reply. Not long after, Jordan's message arrived. No words, just a picture. A picture of me, Jordan, and Tyler wearing our Swift Current Broncos jerseys amongst a crowd full of people, some of whom were obviously Medicine Hat Tigers fans. I found myself saying, okay, God, I've told myself to pray. I'm frustrated, angry, and don't understand any of this. I added, and I don't want to go through this anymore. The time reached 2:57, then 2:58, 2:59. Almost without meaning to, I again started counting to 60. With the count somewhere around 55, it's so hard to count seconds accurately, my conscious experience shifted. I no longer sat in my apartment. I was back on the plane at Toronto's airport. God has done nothing to stop this day skipping or help me understand it. Frustration and anger returned. The plane continued to taxi toward a terminal gate. It crawled. I seethed. The plane angled toward a jet bridge, which extended out like a vacuum hose. I turned on my phone. 3:09 p.m. local time, Monday, January 5th. Still stuck in the 2 p.m. Saskatchewan hour. The phone beeped and chirped a few times with new texts and social media notifications. I scanned through them, but didn't feel inclined to reply. I did reply to one text from Mom and Dad. How are you feeling? But kept the answer short. All's good. What a lie. The aircraft stopped. Passengers unbuckled and prepared to disembark. I realized others in the plane were retrieving carry-on items from overhead storage compartments. I have my waste pack. Did I bring anything else? I stood and checked the nearby compartments. Sure enough, I found my small carry-on bag there, the one I always kept stocked with a few essentials in case the other luggage got lost. That thought pulled me up short. Do I have other luggage? I wondered in a quiet voice. I scowled and added an intentional thought. Too bad if I do have other luggage. I guess it'll be making the trip to Paris without me. Because I had decided more subconsciously than consciously that I would not continue the journey. Despite the selfie video taken in Paris, despite the written note found on my table, I had absolutely no intention of going on. Instead, I would go back, miss the flight to Frankfurt, and catch the next flight back to Regina. I am taking back my life, I told myself. I grinned with satisfaction. But a quiet, simple objection immediately erased the grin. My life? That hit me like a jab in the stomach. I pushed it out of my mind. Sir, do you need assistance? Came a voice behind me, making me jump. I was still standing with one hand reached into the overhead compartment. I plucked my bag from its spot. No thanks, I replied, glancing back at the flight attendant. I checked my seat one last time and joined the line of passengers exiting the plane. My feet thumped against the thinly carpeted metal floor of the jet bridge. Gate D22, I noted as I came out into Terminal 1 of Pearson International. A sign for information pointed right. I followed. I intended to inquire immediately about a flight back to Regina. I saw the time displayed on an overhead clock, 3:22 p.m. I waited in line by the service counter near the exit entrance to the D pier. My fingers twitched impatiently. Finally, at 3:33 p.m., an agent nodded in my direction. Could I I started, but the tightness in my clenched throat forced me to stifle a cough. The agent answered the question she assumed I'd wanted to ask. You need some information about your connecting flight? Certainly. Pearson can seem like a pretty big place. Let me see your boarding pass, please. This caught me by surprise. For some reason, I meekly unzipped my waste pack and handed the relevant ticket to the agent. Oh, no problem, she intoned. Air Canada Flight 872 to Frankfurt, leaving gate E75 at 4:40. That leaves you over half an hour to get to the boarding gate, lots of time. Just walk through the exit behind me, take an escalator up to level 3, and continue through the concourse and all the F gates to the E gates at the end of the pier. Please have all documentation ready, okay? I stood arguing with myself for a moment. Ask her about the next flight back to Regina, I prompted myself. But an opposing thought countered. No, don't. You probably already look stressed out. You want to attract suspicion in an airport? Just go and find someone else to ask. So I smiled politely, said, thank you, and wandered out of the D-pier toward an escalator. I sighed as I stepped onto the moving stairway. My angry resolve of a few minutes ago seemed to be evaporating. Woodenly, my legs propelled me forward once I reached the top of the escalator. I walked through the concourses and presented my passport and boarding pass at a security check. I went past the F gates, then into the E area. Gate E75, 3:52 p.m. I didn't go to the agents at the gate. Instead, I sat down on a bench in the concourse. The energy which my anger had supplied was gone. I decided to wait for the next day skip at 4, or perhaps for the breaking of the awful cycle. The clocks ticked off the remaining minutes. I felt wakefulness creeping upon me. I stretched and yawned, felt rested. But what strange dreams! I heard a door close out in the hall, voices speaking French. That didn't seem right. I sat up and looked to the right side of the bed. My bedroom clock should have been sitting there. It was on the left side of the bed. 9:21 p.m. This is definitely not home. The clock's glow dimly illuminated a lamp sitting beside it. I fumbled for a switch. Light revealed a hotel room. A memory surfaced, finding a hotel keycard in my jacket pocket. I looked around, found a brochure on the bedside table, and read, Hotel International, Paris. I groaned. I'm in Paris again! I wasn't dreaming! I tore the brochure in two. The frustration and anger of the last several hours, the same hour spread over 4 days, surged back into my soul. I grabbed my cell phone. The display said 9:23 p.m., Tuesday, January 6th. I already knew Paris was 7 hours ahead of Saskatchewan, so yes, it is the 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. hour back home, the hour I'd experienced on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. The fierce resolve which had surfaced at Toronto's airport returned, and I very clearly informed the walls of my hotel room, I won't do anything. I will ignore these day skips. I will not help the French authorities with their investigation. I checked the video collection on my phone. There were no new selfie videos. In fact, the one I had already viewed wasn't there either. Guess I haven't recorded it yet. Good. I never will record it. Nor were there any handwritten notes from myself. Double good. I'm getting tired of my own advice. I wondered how much the hotel room cost for a night. My stomach growled. I'll find something to eat after I wash up. I wondered when I'd last showered. I ignored the time. I showered long. When finished, I wrapped a towel around myself and looked in the mirror, stubbly cheeks. Nothing like a good shave, I exclaimed as I found my razor and shaving cream. I began to lather up and found myself sitting on a bench on the edge of Place de la République, watching the Je suis Charlie crowd on a Paris Wednesday evening. My lips pressed together in a tight line as inside a volcano of frustration erupted again. Another day skip! I refuse to take part in any of this. I won't think about any of it. My bitterness churned itself into an idea. I lifted my phone toward my face, grimly noting it was 9:01 p.m., minus 7 equaled 2:01, same hour again in Saskatchewan, found a map application, and in the directions tool typed from Place de la République to Hotel International, Paris. The screen displayed various walking and driving routes back to the hotel. None were long, but being uncertain with the area, I didn't relish the idea of finding my way on foot at night. Taxi? But the display also showed a Paris metro option, the subway. Hey, the entrance should be right behind this square. Craning my neck to look down the street, I spotted a metro sign. I quickly left the somber crowd behind, and in a minute or so reached the subway entrance. I followed the stair below street level. In the underground station, ticket dispensers waited for customers. Uh-oh, do I have any French or European money? I retrieved my wallet from the waste pack and to my relief found Euro banknotes and coins inside. Briefly wondered how I got them. A ticket cost 1 euro 80 cents. I plugged coins into a slot and with a buzz, a paper ticket slid from the dispenser. An automated gate accepted the ticket and allowed me to pass onto the train platform. Now what? I studied my phone. I needed to board an eastbound train toward Mairie de Lille on Line 11 and get off at the first stop. While waiting, I noted the artwork and advertising on the station walls. I allowed myself to slightly enjoy the experience, but then two armed security personnel came into sight. Oh yeah, a terrorist attack happened here today. That serious thought did not, however, diminish the sense of carelessness I existed in. At 9:20, a white metro train with a blue stripe on the level of the windows pulled into the station. Its destination displays read Mairie de Lille, Lyon. Doors slid open, passengers emerged, and I, plus many others, boarded. The doors hissed closed. In what seemed like only a minute, the train pulled into Goncourt station, and I stepped out. The directions on my phone said, "Take exit 3." Taking the steps two at a time, a favorite habit, I emerged onto street level. Wow, I am actually starting to enjoy this. "Head southeast on Avenue Parmentier," the phone directed. I did. All directions should be so easy. At least these directions make sense, unlike my note and selfie video. "Turn right onto Rue Auguste Barbier." It was a much narrower street, more like an alley with parking along one side and one lane for vehicles. "Turn left around a curving corner to stay on Rue Auguste Barbier. Destination will be on the left." And there it was, a short 3 or 4 minute walk from Goncourt station, the Hotel International, Paris. I entered the lobby and fished out the key card I'd found in my pocket 1 hour/7 hours previous. "Hello," I greeted the clerk. She gave me her attention with a thin smile. "Do you speak English?" "Yes, sir, I do," she said. She looked tired. "Her city was attacked today," my inner voice explained. Again, this somber thought didn't alter my carefree state. "I can't remember my room number. Can you help me? My name is Kyle Stone from Canada." The clerk checked her records. "May I see some ID, please?" I handed over my driver's license. "Thank you, Mr. Stone. Room 35, fifth floor." I now felt positively happy. "Merci!" Stepping lightly into an elevator, I soon emerged onto the specified floor and found room 35. The keycard caused the electronic lock to buzz with approval and flash green. I turned the door handle and walked in. "Yes, I recognize this room. That's my luggage." I sat on the bed and suddenly felt drained. I knew I'd woken up in this room about 24 hours ago. Had I slept since then? Allowing no more mental attempts to piece together any past or future time frame, I went to shower before sleep. It was 9:42 p.m. The bedside clock read 9:59 when I emerged from the washroom. Frustration returned instantly. "I want to stop these day skips," I snapped, yet I closed my eyes in anticipation. It happened. I found myself sitting in a car's front passenger seat. Bitterness and anger felt like a fist inside. I nearly struck the dashboard, but I held back. The vehicle was a police car, and behind the steering wheel sat a police investigator, Jeremy. "Did it happen?" Jeremy inquired. I remembered I had asked Jeremy to wait with me in the car until the day skip. "That was 7 hours ago in terms of what I've experienced, but only a few minutes ago for him." My answer to the police nationale officer was terse. "Yes." "Where were you these times?" I didn't feel like answering, so my words came with bare information. "Hospital. Museum in my home city. At my home. At Toronto's airport. In my hotel room here in Paris. Then in my hotel room again after coming back from the Place de la République event." I checked the time on my phone. 9:03 p.m. Thursday, January 8th. All of that was in this same hour over the past 6 days. Jeremy whistled softly. "Amazing! Crazy!" I tired of the topic. "Can we talk about something else?" To my surprise, Jeremy's reply was negative. "No, monsieur, we will not talk about something else. I am a police investigator, and I need to understand you for our purposes." He paused, looking thoughtful, then added, "Did you discover information these last day skips that has disturbed you?" "Information about what?" I asked, genuinely wondering, although my tone sounded sarcastic. "About the Charlie Hebdo shootings, the terrorists, or any of the other parts of this mess my country is in," Jeremy explained. I looked away. "No, no new information. Sorry." So I'm merely a tool for their investigation. I felt slighted. Out of the corner of my eye, I could see that Jeremy stared at me for a long, silent moment. Suddenly he took the keys from the ignition and opened his door. "Okay," he said lightly. "Let's go inside. I need to check in and you need a rest." He stepped out of the car. When I didn't move, he looked back inside. "Coming?" I opened the door and emerged into the night air. I followed Blanc to a back door of the police prefecture. After some brief questions from an officer stationed at the door, we traveled through the corridors and elevators until we came to what Jeremy said was his department. "Stay here while I speak to my superiors," he instructed, motioning to a waiting area just outside the department doors. "If you want something, coffee and snacks are available just down the hall." He disappeared behind the closed doors. I did want something, and went looking. I helped myself to coffee and a croissant. "I guess a croissant is the French police equivalent of a donut," my wry sense of humor noted. I returned to the waiting area. The time was 9:21 p.m. At 9:33 p.m., Jeremy reappeared. "Unfortunately, no new positive developments here either," he reported. He looked tired and discouraged. "Of course, they wondered about you, about what was happening." That last comment needled me, and so my response came with irritation. "Well, I hope you apologized on my behalf for being such a useless curiosity. I'll try to be less inconvenient in the future." Again, Jeremy stared at me for a long moment. He took a seat. Without looking at me directly, Blanc's voice came blunt and clear. "I think you need to be reminded more forcefully, Kyle Stone, that I am not here to play host to a Canadian my comrades believe to be at best mentally deranged. I have been told to keep you with me as long as it is helpful to the investigation. Some in my department still wonder if you are involved with these terrorists, given where you've been and what you've told us." Here he looked sternly into my eyes. "So if I were you, Kyle Stone, I'd have a better attitude, or we will cut you loose, or arrest you as an accomplice in these plots." I was both surprised and angry at this ultimatum, yet I knew I deserved it. "This is not like me. All of this is getting to me, changing me. I am not normally this way." Jeremy calmed. "I will have mercy, Kyle, and forget about this. I choose to believe you're tired, disoriented, and finding it hard to focus on anything except what is happening to you. So, go back to your hotel. Get some sleep. Withdraw from this mess for a time. I'll get an officer to drive you." He paused. "This is not a request." I looked down at my lap, dejected. All I could say was a meek, "Okay." Jeremy made a call, then led me back to the entrance we used earlier. We waited in awkward silence. A police cruiser soon pulled up. Jeremy opened the car's back door, the prisoner compartment I noted, and instructed the driver, "L'Hôtel International, Rue Auguste Barbet." The uniformed officer acknowledged the order. I climbed into the cruiser. Before closing the door, Blanc added, "You've got my number if you need to call or text me. Probably see you in the morning." I nodded, the door closed, and the car started on its way. I checked my phone and, to my surprise, found Jeremy's number in the contacts list. I also noted the time, 9:49 p.m. The driver said nothing, neither did I. I slumped down in my seat. I felt miserable. Because of the day skips, because I'd disappointed the only friend I had at the moment, because I seemed like an unwitting pawn in a game well beyond my control. I knew another day skip would probably come soon. I was correct.